Joining us now is a new president of the Metro Manila Council, San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora. Mayor Zamora, good afternoon to you and thank you for joining us today.
Yes, good afternoon, Carmina, and thank you for having me on ANC.
All right, new responsibility you have right here. What do you think are the challenges before you as you come into this new responsibility, Mayor?
Well, definitely traffic will be a challenge. That's why we are already implementing our adjusted mall hours. We know that during the holidays, people really go to the malls to shop for presents. So we really had to adjust the time that people will go to the malls, and also a moratorium on diggings. So by November 30, all LGU diggings must be covered, along with the MMDA diggings as well. And the single traffic violation system is something that we are still discussing, the single ticketing system. During the meeting last Saturday, it was presented to us by the LTO, and we have formed a technical working group already to study this. Now, in principle, if this is approved, what we will see in Metro Manila, along with the MMDA, is a single ticket, meaning it will be a uniform ticket regardless of LGU. The LGU enforcers will carry the same ticket if a traffic violator from Muntinlupa is apprehended in San Juan. He can pay for the violation in Muntinlupa. He will not have to go to San Juan just to pay. And this will benefit also the people from the provinces, because there are instances wherein people going, for instance, to Ilocos or to Bicol who pass through Metro Manila are apprehended. But of course, they live in an area 300 kilometers away. So they need not come back to Manila just to pay the tickets. They can eventually pay where they live, and this will be credited to the bank accounts of the LGU. So this will need a lot of integration in terms of the systems, the data, the back end for this to work. And of course, we are also pushing to have a standardized traffic violation fee. So the amounts of the violations, we will try our best as 17 Metro Manila mayors to standardize this. So if you are caught for a traffic violation in San Juan, you should pay the same amount if you will be caught for the same violation, for instance, in Pasig, in Taguig, Manila, Quezon City, or Manila.
But the Metro Manila Council, Mayor Zamora, this goes beyond traffic and mobility, correct?
Correct. Yes, but for now, because of the holiday rush, this is our focus. Again, I'm also the co-chairperson of the Regional Development Council. So part of my task also is to approve the proposals for the RDC. This will be in coordination with NEDA. And what's important here is for the Metro Manila Council to have one voice. Carmina, during the peak of the COVID-19 pandemic, we experienced here in Metro Manila that if we have one solid voice, things are really going to be easier. If you remember during the time when we were asked regarding COVID restrictions, Metro Manila mayors were asked what we thought about ECQ, MECQ, if you remember those times. We always had one voice in Metro Manila, and this allowed us to be able to operate and govern better. So this is what I will be pushing for during my term, and I am hoping for the support and cooperation of the Metro Manila mayors for this.
Glad that you mentioned that, because really the Metro Manila Council during the early days of the pandemic, as you said, had one voice and was really instrumental in sort of guiding as well where the IATF should go. But you know, you're a relatively new mayor. You're only on your second term. What do you think is the advantage of this as you head the Metro Manila Council?
Yes, I'm just in my second term. In fact, 3 years and probably 6 months as mayor. But again, I was given this opportunity to serve. That's why I'm very thankful to my fellow mayors. There are five mayors more senior than I. Senior not necessarily by age, but also by terms. There are five mayors that are in the third term now, but I was given the opportunity. They trusted this position to me. So the challenge really is to be able to get everyone to have a consensus for Metro Manila. An advantage of being young is, of course, the youthfulness, the energy, the drive, the motivation to be able to work very well. I'm strong on the ground. I believe that is my strength as mayor of San Juan. When I say on the ground, we really go around the barangays to see what are the problems that have to be solved. So expect that I will do the same for Metro Manila. We will visit all other 16 LGUs, consult them, see what their concerns are, and be able to address these. Of course, we will be coordinating directly also with the MMDA Chairman Don Artes for this. And we are 20 members in the Metro Manila Council. And again, it is really good to have one voice.
Now, it used to be, Mayor Zamora, that for each city, this is in the olden days, right? For each city, it was considered one sort of kingdom for the chief executive. But tell us why it is important now to get rid of that model, and what is the advantage of having a unified metro?
Yes, we are 17 LGUs in Metro Manila, but again, if you look at NCR, we are one big metropolis. We do not have physical borders. We are basically one huge city. That is why it is important to have common policies. Now, going back to traffic policies, if you are caught with a violation in San Juan and it will be a different fine in a different city, it will cause a lot of confusion. So there is always the possibility of us amending our existing ordinances to unify or standardize fines. So I'm not just talking about traffic fines, I'm talking about policies also. Yes, we are autonomous. That is a power given to us by the local government code. But again, we also have to look at the pragmatic situation here that we are one metropolis. So this has worked well during the pandemic. Everyone was able to voice out his or her opinion, but at the end of the day, there was always one decision. So I'm looking forward for the same framework during my term as Metro Manila Council President.
What innovations did the pandemic teach you that would better, that would improve the delivery of services to the constituents of all these LGUs in the Metro, Mayor?
One thing I would like to share, and this is something that I experienced during the pandemic, each LGU had its own best practices. Mm-hmm. But we were never selfish in terms of not sharing, meaning we can always learn from each other our best practices. We can also learn from our mistakes, things that we should not do. And there's nothing wrong with copying things that other LGUs do well. And I believe that that is something that can further strengthen Metro Manila. Let us learn from each other. Let us support each other. And again, we would also like to bring in the dynamics of other regions. What do I mean? We can also be in coordination with the provinces. For instance, the ease of doing business with the Central and Northern Luzon to be able to bring in their produce here to Metro Manila. It may be able to help us get cheaper items coming straight from the provinces. We can also tie up with them in terms of, again, best practices. Also in disaster response. There are so much things that we can do as a metropolis with other regions. And I feel that these are things that can benefit Filipinos in general.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, what do you say to those who may think that, of course, San Juan is a small city. You're able to deliver the services that your constituents need precisely because it is small. Being the president of the Metro Manila Council, that's a different ball game altogether. What do you say to that?
That's correct, Carmina. We are small, but again, it's not about the size, Carmina. It's about the system. It's about the framework. If you're able to do it in a small setting, if you replicate the same system and framework in a bigger setting, you should be able to do it. We are small, yes. That means we have less funding, we have less manpower, we have less logistics. The bigger cities have bigger funding, they have more manpower, they have more logistics. So it's a matter of developing a system that works and implementing this on a larger scale.
Mm-hmm. Talk to us about the role of politics in each and every LGU and how you're going to conquer this and how you're going to be the unifying leader of the local chief executives in the metro.
I will really have to build rapport among the 17 Metro Manila mayors, and I've started to do that. It's really important to get everyone on board. You build relationships with each and every mayor, you discuss with them, and you allow them to air their concerns. And of course, I will have to be the voice. I will have to be the voice of the Metro Manila mayors. So I will make them feel that they can inform me about the concerns that they want me to air out in the Metro Manila Council. And I'm more than willing to do that. I have built relationships with them, especially those I was with during my first term. The new mayors now, the first term mayors, most of them are my friends as well. Some of them are from Congress. They have legislative experience. So we have a nice mix of mayors from 2022 to 2025. And it's really my task now to get everyone together and have the same framework for Metro Manila.
It's no secret that you have a direct line to the president. You are one of the godsons of Senator Aimee Marcos, presidential sister. Do you think that's one major advantage you have as well?
I believe that this relationship with the president or the president's family will be integral, of course, because at the end of the day, he is the president of the Philippines, and whatever concerns Metro Manila will have, he will be the one that can help us, and that's just the reality. So that will also be an advantage, because whatever projects, programs, things that Metro Manila will need, I can articulate to the president and, of course, to the cabinet secretaries. And it will be an advantage, I believe, because we will be able to relay all of these to the national government.
There's one other thing, actually two issues that I want to discuss with you today, Mayor Zamora, real issues this time. Let's talk about the drug war. The new phase of the drug war was launched a couple of days back. A new phase, according to DILG Secretary Benhur Abalos, a system that will adhere to the rule of law, protect basic human rights. How will this look like now, this drug war? How will this look like in the various LGUs in the metro?
Armin, I attended the BIDA launch last Saturday at 6 a.m. at the Quezon City Memorial Circle. I am fully supportive of this. BIDA means Buhay Ingatan, Drug Ay Ayawan. So it is a holistic approach into the drug war, incorporating livelihood, education, the church, addressing the social ills of our country. So we address not just the branches causing the problems, but we will uproot the drug problem. That is the framework of the BIDA program of Secretary Abalos. And earlier I was listening to the first part of your program. You're mentioning a list that will be vetted out. Carmina, one thing I can assure everyone watching now, I am not part of that narco list. Here in San Juan, we have already 18 out of 21 barangays that have been drug cleared. On December 14, our last three barangays will be up for validation by the PIDEA. And if we indeed pass the validation, we will be drug cleared already as a city. So that is something that we are pushing for. I also personally joined drug raids with our police force. I make sure that the implementation of the protocols are correct. And it's also my way of sending the message to everyone involved in drugs and criminality in our city that the mayor is serious in eradicating the drug problem here in San Juan and maintaining peace and order in our city.
18 out of 21, how are you able to do that? And what's keeping you from getting the city rid of drugs and really completing the 21 barangays and making sure that it's cleared of drugs?
Yes, the PIDEA has set a checklist of items that we have to comply with. In fact, the barangays will have to comply with these. And so far, 18 have passed, and we are down to three. That is why just this morning, I spoke to the barangay captains of these three barangays, and I told them that they really have to present very well on December 14. Because if we are able to do this, we will be the first city in Metro Manila to be declared drug-free or drug-cleared. And that is something that we would like to achieve. And again, We are just down to three barangays. So the PDEA will handle the validation along with the composite team from the PNP and the DALG.
Mm. A huge component as well of this new phase of the drug war is rehabilitation. Does San Juan have rehabilitation centers? And is it going to be, you know, one of the innovations as well that you, together with the other city mayors, really beef up the rehabilitation centers located in and around the metro?
Yes, Carmina, we are currently fixing our Balay Silangan. This will be our drug reformation center, wherein there will also be a PDEA office. And this is part of our drug clearing efforts. In fact, a part of the validation is the fact that we are already setting up our Balay Silangan. This will be a reformation center funded by the local government. It is not just a rehabilitation center. It's also an opportunity for them to learn livelihood, to be able to study, to be able to reintegrate them into society. So we look at the PWDs, or the persons who use drugs, as our constituents whom we have to support in terms of getting reintegrated back into the community. Mm. So we are setting this up for them. We will fund this for them, and we will make sure that during their stay here, that they will be able to learn how to go back to normal life. Yes, they have experienced getting into drugs, being hooked into these substances. But again, we have to give them a second chance to be able to reintegrate themselves into the community.
Let's go back to the list that was mentioned a while ago. You said you're not part of that list, but
definitely.
This is not the first time that we've heard of such list. We've heard of lists before and matrices presented to the public. How do you think, or what must be done so that this list, so-called list, will not go the way of the past lists and matrices that the past administration has presented to the public, so that this list will not be weaponized?
I was listening to the interview of Secretary Abalos earlier, and he mentioned that this will be vetted. So it means they will have to filter and validate the list. Of course, go through each and every name and see if indeed they are involved in illegal drugs. And of course, that is something that really has to be done, because for all you know, it's possible that the information that was given may not be correct. So it is but right to validate first. Of course, it will be hard to simply accuse someone of involvement in drugs without any proof. So it would be really best for the DALG to be able to filter this properly, because of course it would be unfair if you will accuse a mayor or any individual of being involved in drugs if there is no proof to this.
There's another issue that we want to talk to you about, and that's the use of the confidential intelligence funds. Use it instead to give cash aid. You've had experience giving out cash aid during the early days of the pandemic, the height of the pandemic. What value do you see in this, that instead of using these monies in confidential intelligence funds, maybe give it out to the people who need it the most and maybe pump it back to the economy? That's what ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro has been saying. Go ahead, Mayor.
I am not privy to how the national government uses its confidential funds, because they have a different dynamics. Here in the local government, we have our confidential funds, and it's computed based on the POPS plan, the peace and order plan. So what are the things we use this for? We use this for peace and order operations, to be able to monitor illegal drug trade, to go after the pushers, to make sure that the criminality level is very low. In fact, here in San Juan, we are the city with the lowest crime rate in Metro Manila. So we use this basically for operations to be able to get the information. Hmm. Now, if this will be converted into livelihood programs to help people, if it is allowed under the law, if the Commission on Audit will say that it is indeed utilizable, then maybe it is something that can be considered. But again, I am not privy, Carmina, to the proposals now in Congress, because all I'm privy to is the local government utilization of the confidential funds.
Mm-hmm. Well, just as a final question, speaking as a local chief executive, what do you think your constituents need more, intelligence funds or cash aid or something that would help uplift their lives? Go ahead.
There must be a good balance because, again, confidential funds, it has helped us. You asked earlier how we achieved having 18 out of 21 barangays drug cleared. The confidential funds really helps us a lot because there are a lot of operations that we cannot technically divulge into a full budget disposition, meaning we cannot compromise the operations of the police in terms of monitoring or conducting a drug by bus operation. So that means we have to tap the confidential funds for this. So has it helped San Juan? Yes, because number one, we are the city with the lowest crime rate in Metro Manila. Number two, we are just three barangays away from being a drug cleared city. So it's basically the proper utilization of this. We submit this for liquidation. The Commission on Audit audits it. We liquidate it. And so far, we have not had any problems in terms of liquidation during my first 3 years as mayor, and now that I have started my second term. Mm-hmm.
And what about cash aid?
Well, if it will be allowed for cash aid, then that will give us a lot of flexibility. But here in San Juan, we have appropriated separate funds for cash aid. And of course, during the pandemic, we realigned a lot of our funds for cash aid and food assistance. We were able to implement 19 waves of food packs, ayudas, during the height of the pandemic because I made the decision to put in the back seat some projects which I feel can be done later on. Mm. And we converted it to more day-to-day important things such as food and medicines for our people.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora there, the new president of the Metro Manila Council. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Carmina.
Thanks again.
Thank you.